Hello, my name is Tony Felici, and I'm the senior pastor here at Holiday Park United Methodist Church in Plum Borough, where Christ is King, the Holy Spirit inspires, people's lives are being transformed on a daily basis, all to the glory of God. And we're so glad that you have joined us for this broadcast today on Cornerstone TV's Faith and Family channel. Won't you join us to worship our Lord? Let us go to God in prayer. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The hour is coming, and now is, when true worshipers will worship the Father both in spirit and in truth, for such the Father seeks to worship him. Amen. Would you please stand with us for this morning's call to worship? As a shepherd seeks a lost sheep, like a woman who searches for a lost coin until it's found, as a father receives a returning wayward son, therefore let us together praise God in thanksgiving that we are received. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 577, God of Grace and God of Glory. Let us sing together with joy.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for our confession and prayer of pardon. We do not presume to come to your table of grace, merciful Lord, trusting in our own goodness, but in your unfailing mercies. We are not worthy that you should receive us, yet only you give the word, and we shall be healed through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. God, who is rich in mercy out of his great love for us, even when we were dead through our sins, made us alive together in Christ. For by grace we have been saved through faith. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God.
Glory, amen. Glory be to God. Amen. As forgiven then and reconciled children of the living God, why don't we offer to one another some sign and form of Christ's peace and love? Well, good morning. How are you all doing this morning? You doing really well? How many here are going on vacation soon? Where are you going to go?
Ocean City.
That's a
vacation tomorrow.
Are you all packed? You're all packed and ready to go. How about you? When are you going on vacation? Soon? Oh, you're going to Maine. That's a good place to go. Who else is going away? You just got back from a trip, huh, down to Disney World. Did you have fun? Now, when you went on your trip, did you bring a suitcase?
Yeah.
Did you pack it? What did you put in your suitcase?
Clothes.
Yeah. Well, listen, I was just recently away for like a day. Well, actually 2 days. I had some eye surgery. And by the way, thank you for your prayers for my eye surgery. So Dottie packed a bag for me for my 1 day. and in here, there's like all kinds of stuff that you need to travel. Now, one of the things that you need, that I need to travel with, is my computer. Okay? Why do I need a computer when I travel? I don't know, it just makes me feel comfortable to have my computer with me everywhere I go. Besides, sometimes you guys are always sending me emails and things like that, and I have to be able to be connected. I have to be able to hear what you have to say. So I got to, even though I'm away, I have to be connected. I always have to bring one of these. What's this?
Charger.
A charger for my what?
Phone.
My phone. Do you think I left my phone in here?
Yeah.
No. It's on my desk. So I can't show you my phone, but it's here in the building with me. And then in here, we've got all kinds of things. Like, what's this? There is a first aid kit in here. It's my shaving kit. Some people say, shaving kit? You don't look like you shave. Yeah, I shave here and there and underneath here. Okay, got to shave over here. No. Then I have my trusty hair dryer. Okay? Because a lot of places you go to, they don't always have hair dryers. Now, where we went, there was hair dryers and there was actually toiletries, like, you know, shower gel and shampoo and conditioner. But here's my little fold-up hair dryer from Brookstone. It really works well. It's really powerful for the size that it is. So, you know, when you go and you travel, you just have to have all these different things. Got to have a hairbrush, right? You got to have toothpaste, right? Because who wants stinky breath, right? Well, you know, why am I showing you all these things? What do you think?
Because
Because I'm getting ready to go on the, why do you think? Ah, you're smart. There's probably something that ties in with a Bible story today, right? So Jesus was with his disciples. And he was not with just the apostles, but he was with the disciples because it tells us in the scripture that there was 72 of them. And Jesus wanted to send them out on a journey ahead of him. He was sending them out like an advance team. Go and get everyone ready for my coming. And so he was sending them out. And what do you think he told them to take for the journey? What kind of a suitcase? Like a basket. How many say a basket? Or like a pouch? Or how about like extra sandals? Or an extra tunic, right? No, Jesus said, "Behold, I am sending you out like lambs among the wolves." Now, I want you to picture that for a second. How do you think lambs do with a bunch of wolves?
They die.
They die, right? It's not a good combination, right? It's not the wolves unless they're like trained wolves. It's not like they're going to just leave the sheep alone, right? They look at the sheep, they say, "Ooh, a tasty morsel," right? And the lambs really can't defend themselves, can they? But Jesus says, "Behold, I'm sending you out like lambs among the wolves. And on this journey, I don't want you to take anything. Nothing. Just go out." Why do you think Jesus would send them out without anything? Go ahead.
Because they have God with them.
Oh, wow. Because they have God with them. That's exactly right. He was equipping them with his power. They were going out like lambs among the wolves so that when they went into this enemy territory, okay, they wouldn't be harmed and they would be effective. And he said, no matter where you go, stay there. When you announce peace upon the house and they return peace to you, stay there and eat whatever it is that they give you. Okay, in other words, and don't go to another house. Just stay in that place until you go to another town. But he says, if they don't receive you well, if they don't receive your peace, we just passed peace in here. And if someone said, "I don't want your peace," then he says to shake the dust off, okay, and go somewhere else. In other words, don't waste any more time there, but tell them this, that the kingdom of heaven is near. Let them know that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's available to them. And they don't have to dismiss it. They should receive it, okay? But he wants us to know that it's his power that helps us to reach people. Not our own power. Not our own suitcases. God's going to provide us no matter where he sends us. He's going to equip us to do what he sends us out to do. Does that sound like a good deal? God is always with you. And he's always in you. And he will make your journeys great. Now listen. Does that mean that next time you go on vacation, you're not going to pack a suitcase?
Uh-uh.
No. No, because the next time he sent them on the journey, he says, "Hey, pack an extra tunic, and if someone needs it, give it to them." Okay? But on this particular case, Jesus wanted them to know that the power wasn't from them. It was from him. Okay? Let's pray. God, the power is not in us, but in you. And yet, Lord, you lend us your power. You live in us. You give us the power and the presence of your own Holy Spirit so that we might be equipped to do the ministry in your name. That wherever we go, that you have already been there. That you have prepared the people for our journey. And no matter where we go or no matter how far we come back, that you are always there for us. And so, Lord, we thank you for the gift of your grace. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit in these children, Lord. Grow them with wisdom and knowledge and love of you every day of their life, that they might be your disciples and that they might invite others into your grace. For it's in Jesus' precious name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. You guys getting ready for Vacation Bible School in a couple of weeks?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be a fun time. Invite your friends to that, okay? Use this opportunity to invite your friends, your neighbors, to come to Vacation Bible School with you. Does that sound like a good deal? Yeah, yeah. And if they don't have the money, we'll come up with the money for them, okay? Oh, we'll see. So Lucy just told me, by the way, we don't charge for Vacation Bible School. Maybe we should start. No, just kidding.
This is the Old Testament reading from 2 Kings 5, verses 1 through 14. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him, the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means, go," the king of Aram replied. "I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me?" When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message, "Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, "Go, wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." But Naaman went away angry and said, "I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot, and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed?" So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for your amazing love. Your love for us is so great that you gave up your beloved Son Jesus so that we could share in your miraculous plan for our salvation. By your grace, our sins are forgotten. Our slates are wiped clean, and we thank you. We want to use our lives to glorify you, Father. In the passage we just heard about Naaman in 2 Kings chapter 5, we learned about a young servant girl from Israel who knew exactly how to use her life to glorify you. Naaman was a strong and a powerful and a very successful commander in the King Aram's army. But he had a weakness. He had leprosy. The young servant girl had been taken captive by Naaman's men, and in spite of being in a foreign country and being a captive of war, she was the key to transforming Naaman's life. She initiated Naaman's hope by directing him to your healing power by way of Israel's prophet Elisha. Father, may we also be the key to transforming other people's lives. Use us as instruments of your peace and send us out to our world that struggles with evil and with chaos. That servant girl may not have even known that she initiated all the events leading to Naaman's cleansing, which came as a result not of his strength or power, but of his willingness to believe. Father, help us to not only spread your message of salvation, but also to serve others compassionately. Many are here this morning, Father, with difficult situations that are weighing heavily on their minds. We pray for your peace to find its way to all those in need. Extend your healing power to those who are facing illness and comfort those who grieve. Restore broken relationships and welcome us back to you when we wander from your way. And we pray, Lord, that you come be with us as we all join together and pray the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our stewardship nugget for this morning comes to us from the book of Exodus, the 25th chapter, verses 1 through 7. Hear these words. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to bring me an offering. You are to receive the offering for me from everyone whose heart prompts them to give. Now these are the offerings you are to receive from them: gold, silver and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and fine linen, goat hair, ram skins dyed red, and other type of durable leather, acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for the fragrant incense, and onyx stones and other gems to be mounted on the ephod and the breastpiece." Well, Moses was being commanded to get the people of Israel, the people that had been in bondage, the people that had been enslaved in Egypt, while they were in the midst of the desert. Before they left Egypt, God had caused the Egyptian people to give jewelry, gold, silver, all these things that have been named. They were all given to the Israelites for their journey. They just wanted them to get out. Get out and here, take this stuff. And God said to Moses, "I want you to ask for an offering so that it could be used in the worship setting." It was to be used in the tabernacle that they created as a worship space that was a mobile sanctuary that would go throughout the desert, and they would be able to worship God in that place. And so all these gifts, all these offerings were meant to worship God so that we might have a place, so that they might have that worship would be from them as well as from the whole community. And he said, anyone that has a heart to give, let them give. And here's the things that they need to give. We also receive tithes and offerings for our worship, as well as sending them out for other ministry throughout the world. But we are blessed to be a blessing, and we are blessed to be a worshipful people. Will the ushers come forward to receive our tithes, our gifts, and our votive offerings here this morning? God truly has blessed us to be a blessing in this community. Lord God Almighty, we thank you always in every way for the many and the varied gifts that you have bestowed upon each and every one of us. Many of the gifts, we don't even know what they are or how they have come to us, but your hand has always been at work in the receiving of these gifts. So we return a portion of that which you have given to us back into your hands this morning. We ask that you would bless these gifts, but bless also all those that bring them here today, that we might honor you with this giving, that we might perform the things that you ask us to perform, and that we might worship you in spirit and in truth, all to the glory of God the Father in heaven, by the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit, through your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen. I invite us to be seated.
Alex told us about his mission trip to Africa. What a wonderful opportunity to be an ambassador of our church, of our United Methodist Conference, and of our country. Last week, we had reports from the mission team to Philippines. To that team, R&R meant roof and ramp. But the mission isn't just for these people who were these chosen few. It's all of ours. It's not even the 72 people that Jesus sent out that Tony told the children about. All of us are on the mission to serve the needy and each other and to make disciples for Jesus Christ throughout our community and the world. There's a call going out across the land in every nation. A call to all who swear allegiance to the cross of Christ. A call to true humility, to live our lives responsibly, to deepen our devotion to the cross at any price. Let
Let us then be sober, moving only in the Spirit, as aliens and strangers in a hostile foreign land. The message we're proclaiming is repentance and forgiveness. The author of salvation to the dying race of man. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, to spring from which our service overflows across the street or around the world. The mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. As a candle is consumed by the passion of the flame, spilling light unsparingly throughout a darkened room, let us burn to know him deeper than our service. Flaming bright, we'll radiate his passion and blaze with holy light. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the drink from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. The heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission.
Amen. Thank you, Bruce, and thank you, Dan, for that wonderful message. I don't even need to preach now because that said it all. Would you please stand with me for the hearing and the reading of this morning's gospel message that comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 1 through 20. Hear these words. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. So ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field. Now go, I am sending you out like lambs among the wolves. Do not take a purse or a bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. And when you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they gave you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. And when you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. But when you enter a town and are not welcome, go into the street and say, even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted to the heavens? No, you will go down to Hades. Whoever listens to you listens to me. Whoever rejects you rejects me. But whoever rejects me rejects him who sent me. The 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. He replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rather rejoice that your names are written in heaven. And so this ends the reading of his holy word, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you to be seated. I invite you also to pray along with me, please. God of love and God of life, God who gives us his self so that we might be equipped for every good deed, Lord, we give you thanks. We thank you for the gift of these couple of readings that we heard here this morning, and we ask that you would take each of them and emblazon them onto our hearts, that we might be and become the people that you created us to be, people who, when you send us, go, people who go with your power in them, and your spirit to direct us in our life, to direct us in our paths. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. For this in Jesus' precious name we pray these things. Amen. A couple of notes before I begin the sermon today. First of all, I want to thank you all for your prayers for the surgery that I had this past week on Tuesday. And for the Tuesday that was previous to that, they did both my right and left eyes. And I have to say to you, I want to thank you for your prayers. I want to thank my surgeon, Dr. Christie, who did just a wonderful job. And the vision that I now have is better than the vision I've ever had. And my night vision is amazing. So I'm very, very thankful. I'm thankful to you for your prayers. And I'm thankful for what they're able to do, but I'm most of all thankful to the God who gives me grace. I'm also thankful for your prayers for my mom, who's doing well. She's in a rehab hospital called Whittier Hospital. It's a brand new place, and so she's got really nice accommodations. They're treating her very well. And we just found out this past week that the cancer that started as colon cancer with her, and that she was cancer-free for about 22 years, now she has ovarian cancer, which has caused her to have some fluid in her lungs and in her abdomen, which they drained. She is not in pain. We talked to her the other day, and she said she is very comfortable. She's not in pain of any kind, and they're not going to do treatment for her. We don't know how long she has, but she's comfortable, she's doing well. My family is visiting her all the time, which makes her happy and joyous. So I just ask your continued prayer for my mom, Elizabeth Marie Felici. And but God is good, and God has been good to her. I've always prayed for my mom for a long and fruitful life. She's 98. And so I thank God for her wonderful lived life that continues on. And who knows how long that will be. But God does know. And so we rest in the care. We know that he always provides. But thank you for your prayers for her. Thank you for your prayers for me. And thank you for the people that you are. This morning's two messages that we have, we first find people that are traveling. And, you know, Jesus is telling the 72 to go out. And in the earlier reading with Elisha the prophet and Naaman, he goes and travels so that he might get relief, that he might get healing, that he might be cured. And what does he take on his journey? How many talents of silver? How many shekels of coins? I mean, he had a whole contingent traveling with him because they thought they could buy healing. He thought he could buy healing. His king thought he could send a message to the king. Now, the message that they got, that there was a prophet in Israel, but the king sends a letter to the king, not to the prophet. And the king, what's he do? He starts to tear his clothes because he's in mourning because he can't do this. This is not his role. Am I God? He says, am I God? Can I heal you? Can I cause someone to die and raise them up to life again? No, I can't do that. And he tears his clothes instead of saying, you need to go see the prophet Elisha. But Elisha sends word to the king, why did you tear your clothes? Tell them to come here. And yet, here's Naaman thinking that the prophet will come out to him. He just sends a contingent, a messenger, to tell him what he needs to do. And when he receives the message of what he needs to do, he doesn't want to do it. Don't we have better places in Damascus? Don't we have better rivers flowing there? Aren't they cleaner than the Jordan? Have you seen the Jordan lately? And yet he has good people in his household. The first person in his household that was an Israelite slave was the one that let him know about the prophet that could bring healing. And then another attendant to him said, Master, if you had been asked to do something great, would you not have done it? And yet they just said, go and wash in the Jordan. That's all you need to do? Wouldn't that be a good thing to do? Shouldn't you just try it? So he does. And lo and behold, he is totally healed. And it says that his skin, which was leprous, now is like the skin of a baby boy. As sweet as can be. And God did that through the prophet Elisha. Jesus, in the gospel message that we read today, and you saw my suitcase, he's sending the prophets to go out, the 72, the disciples to go out like lambs among the wolves. And the kids were right. Lambs don't have a chance against wolves. But Jesus knows that they're not alone. That they're going in power. That he's going to go before them. He's going to prepare the way for them. And if they just announce peace to wherever it is that they go, if that peace is received, that peace will rest on that household. He says to them that wherever you go and you proclaim peace, that peace will remain there. But if it's not received, then go from that place. You know, and if you go to a place, to a town that doesn't receive the, shake the dust off your feet of that town. But say to them that the kingdom of heaven has come near. It's been available to you. It's there for your asking. And then give them this warning. And the warning that we had is usually stricken from the gospel reading. So you would read from here to there and then skip this verse and then these three verses and read here. But I chose to keep it in because the warning was about Tyre and Sidon that were condemned, right? That were thrown down. And yet he says it would have been better for Tyre and Sidon in the day of the judgment than it would be for the people that actually saw God's grace at work And so that's it's an important message for us, because we see God's grace at work all the time. And so he says, if you see God's grace at work, receive it with joy, and then live into that grace. Be extenders of that grace. Proclaim peace to everyone you know. And if they don't receive that peace, that's on them. But you have given peace. And the kingdom of heaven has come near. I showed you my case for traveling for 2 days. Okay, and we were at our friend's bed and breakfast right after my surgery, because our surgeon said, I don't want you doing anything right after the surgery. Basically, I want you to lay down and go to sleep for about 3.5 hours, because I don't want you focusing. I don't want you, you know, taxing that eye. And I don't want you reading or watching TV or lifting any weights. So the best thing you can do is go find some place to go lay down. So we went to our friend's bed and breakfast, and we figured, well, we'll let them take care of us. And we went to that place. And Dottie and I, you know, we've been on this diet. And so we got this Weight Watcher app, and we have certain things that we can eat. And so they asked us, well, like for tomorrow morning, what kind of breakfast do you want? And we said, very simple, just a couple of eggs, it's 0 points for us. You know, no toast. Well, Dottie wanted one piece of toast. I said, no toast for me. No juice, because it's like 6 points, you know, and no bacon, no this. You know, just a very simple breakfast. You don't have to do anything special. Cup of coffee. Yeah, coffee. Yeah, we'll take that. So we get up and we go to breakfast, and here's this breakfast. We get this breakfast, and I'm looking in my Weight Watchers app, and it's like, well, 27 points. We only get, like, Dottie gets 23 in a day, and I get 25. I'm like, ooh. But then I'm remembering the scripture that I read, that whatever is put before you, you got to eat. Okay, God. So I ate the waffle. Dottie didn't eat the waffle. But, and I didn't gain any weight, so it was fat-free. That's why I'm saying, buy these submarines. Okay, that's God's grace. Buy these submarines, okay, to send Alex out, right? Because we're sending them. We want to prepare for him. So buy a bunch of submarines so we can send them, and so we can also bring them back, right? Because it's important. We want to bring you back, right? We don't want to just send you. We want you to come home, right? In the reading today, the 72 went out. They were faithful. They did what God had told them to do. They were effective because God was with them. But then they came back home, right? And they celebrated. They came back home and they celebrated what God was able to do through them and with them. God always is with his people. And whenever he sends us out, he's already been before us. Wherever he sends us out to go, he's already done the groundwork. It's already been done. So what we need to do then is to just listen, be faithful, and trust that God is already at work. And as we join him in the work, that's the chabaza that you were talking about, join someone who is already at work. You know, that's what they talk about in Africa, is you don't go to someone who's sitting down and not doing anything. You go beside someone who's already engaged in work. Our God is always at work. He's always working in the world. So look where he's working, join him in that effort, and he will multiply your efforts, and God's grace will abound. Behold, I am sending you out like lambs among the wolves. Boy, watch out, wolves, because when you go with God, those wolves don't have a chance. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, that is who you are, Almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving, and you give us abounding grace. We don't need anything but you. We don't need to take an extra tunic or an extra toothbrush or any of these things, Lord, because you have already been there. You have already done the yeoman's work. You just ask us to be a part of it. And we then are blessed. Not only are they blessed, but we are blessed because we listen to you. The kingdom of heaven has come near. And the kingdom of heaven, as Jesus said, is within you. So allow us, Lord, to believe that. Allow us to live our lives in that way. in the spirit of truth, in the spirit of worship. For it's in Jesus' precious name we pray these things. Amen. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he was having that Passover meal with his disciples. And he wanted to prepare them for his departure. And he wanted them to know that they were going to be just fine. So he takes the bread from that meal, and it wouldn't have looked like this. It would have been flat, it would have been unleavened. It would have been sinless bread, no leaven in it, symbolic of evil in that case. And Jesus thanks God for the bread. He blesses the bread, and then he breaks it and he gives it to his disciples, and he says, "Take and eat. This is my body, which will be broken for you." And after the supper was finished, and that's important, because after the Passover supper, there was a cup that was called the cup of redemption. And Jesus takes this cup, the cup that followed the meal, and he says, "This cup of redemption is the cup of my blood, which will be shed for you and for all, so that there'll be redemption, so that sins may be forgiven, and that you'll be free to worship in spirit and in truth." The cup of salvation, the cup of redemption, the cup of Jesus poured out blood. In the United Methodist Church, we celebrate what we call an open table of grace. What we mean by that is we could not prevent you, if we wanted to, from receiving anything from this table. Grace means unmerited favor. It means none of us here deserve it, but God wants to give it. And so the work and the bought price was paid on the cross by Jesus. And he said that it is finished. So everyone is welcome that wants to follow Jesus as Lord and God and Savior. So would the ushers come forward to distribute the communion elements, please? This is the body of Christ. It's broken for you and broken for me, so that we might be made whole. Take and eat and feel the wholeness of God in you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you and shed for me. Take and drink and be filled with his Holy Spirit. Let us pray. God of grace, God of glory, God of promises and God of promises kept, we thank you for the promise of your love. We thank you for the promise of forgiveness. We thank you that you are always with us and in us, so that the kingdom of heaven not only has drawn near, it's within us, as Jesus told us. So allow us to go out with boldness and confidence to proclaim your awesome truth and to invite others into your grace. For it's in Jesus' precious name we pray these things. Amen. Our final hymn for this morning is Come Sinners to the Gospel Feast. You notice it doesn't say come saints, but come sinners to the Gospel Feast, because we sinners really need that grace. Let us stand and sing to our God. Come ye this moment at his call and live for him who died for all. What a great song. What a great message. Hey, I have another one thing that I meant to share with you today. If you've received an email from me from a tfelice.holidayparkumc.gmail, it's not from me. Okay, that's not my email address. Someone has maliciously gone and created an email in my name and in the name of Holiday Park. And there are people, they're soliciting like a $300 gift card and you to give them a picture of that. That's not me. And I would never ask or solicit funds for anyone in the community that way. You'd get a call from me, or you'd get a letter, or you'd hear it like we did with the hoagie sales from the pulpit, so that you know it's from us. So if you get something like that, check the source. Dan called me yesterday. He says, hey, you said you were reaching out to me. I'm calling you. And I said, I didn't reach out to you, but it was this. And there were others that let me know about it. So it's not me. Our email address is tfelice@holidaypark.org. And so if you see a Gmail, anyone can go and create a Gmail account. I can create a Gmail account in your name. It's so loose. So please watch and verify your sources. Don't be duped by that. They're asking for grace, but they're taking it for themselves. And so please don't fall prey to that. But do this. Go and live the life in Jesus' name. Go and share his grace with everyone that you know. And go and live the life strongly, because he is with you, he is in you, and he will never leave, nor will he ever forsake you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Once again, thank you for joining us in worship today. And remember, our prayer is that you would be blessed and strengthened by the power of Jesus Christ in your life, and that you would live a life of abundance and fellowship, joy, and liberty. Holiday Park Church is here for you, and we are more than a church. We are a fellowship of believers coming together to declare the glory of the Lord and celebrate Jesus as King. We study the Word, we practice what we learn, and in the process, we grow together, all to the glory of God. May God richly bless you.